Hello everyone, my name is Jihoon Jung, creator of this YouTube channel Information and Intelligence. Nowadays, more and more people from outside Korea is visiting my YouTube channel, so that I decided to try start English lecture. This is the first try, so that I'm a little bit nervous. For the Korean listeners, I'll post Korean subtitle for this lecture. And I'll post Korean. I want you to know that I'll lecture in Korean too. Don't be too disappointed. Okay, so, I want to start introduce myself first. I graduated Hanyang University Medical College and I've got medical doctor degree from there. And I started my master degree for public health at Seoul National University. At the time, my master's thesis title was Patient Satisfaction Analysis and Quality Improvement in Hospital Management. I used case-based reasoning and decision trees such as C4-5 and CART association rule called a priori for analyzing the question and answers. Yes, that is the good old-fashioned AI technologies, but at that time, that was working quite well. After that, I started my PhD degree at USC on biomedical engineering. I majored in optics and my PhD research theme was multimodal optical imaging. The key issues of my research was managing n-dimensional big image data to make human perceptible efficiently. So most of my research was focused on dimensionality reduction using PCA, ICA, etc. And unsupervised learning such as k-means, clustering algorithm, and smart signature selection processes with embedded databases. After my PhD period, I came back to Korea and worked for hospitals and universities. Currently, I'm senior teaching fellow of Gyeonggi Cyber University, media and communication major. I also had a position at KAIST, Korea Advanced Institute for Science Technologies, Graduate School of Cultural Technologies, and Adjunct Professor. At that time, my major interest was VR, virtual reality and augmented reality, smart object and space kind of things, and human-computer interactions. I wrote many books in Korea on various themes, such as computer programming, trends, and future scenarios, and Nowadays, I'm writing science fiction novel at CoinDesk Korea. I've also worked for many Korean companies as an advisor, Samsung Electronics, NHN, LG Electronics, Hyundai Auto Companies, some of them. As an angel investor, I've invested more than 50 startup companies so far. Now, I co-founded two angel investing and startup accelerator companies, Big Bang Angels and the Digital Healthcare Partners, and also working for those companies as managing partner and partner respectively. But maybe this is much more popular than who I am in English speaking people. Have you seen this picture? When there is a ranking introducing latest guy page, this is almost always introduced. Actually, this is my son. I uploaded this picture at Twitter at the time and that was popular. So I am the father of world latest boy. Just remember that. Okay, now we need to start lectures. I picked up my first lecture theme on deep learning on healthcare. Actually, this lecture was given to Google, Sloan School at MIT, Center for Data Science at NIU, and Massachusetts General Hospital. And also I spoke at Nvidia GTC Korea last year on these themes. This is more like MBA style lecture based on my experiences, especially on my investment portfolio companies. I'll try to explain what is the reality and myth when you guys try to do something using deep learning on healthcare. This is a totally different story from just research. This is quite a long lecture for just an online lecture, so that I'll divide this lecture into several episodes, times about 10 to 15 minutes or slightly longer. Let's start. Firstly, I want to explain what deep learning can do for healthcare. There are four different stakeholders: patient, medicine, public, and pharmacies. Medicine, including hospital doctors. Each of them has different needs and restrictions. For patient and medicine, machine learning can help to understand the physiological changes over time. We can estimate what was going on based on the health record and lab and medical imaging data, and we can forecast progression or onset of the disease. This is called prognosis, and estimating prognosis after the diagnosis and/or treatment intervention is very important in medicine and also for the patient. Finally, we expect personalizing treatment strategies in near future based on genetics, health, and lifestyle data. I forgot to thank Daniela Belgrave for adopting these amazing slides and items. I will use her material in next slides too. For population health, for the public, this means for the public. Machine learning can do more complex job. It can help to elucidate average effect and deviations from average effect. For the public people, it is very important to know what's the average, since it is related with cost efficiency, but it is also important to know when we can find out deviations from average effect. Based on the machine learning result, decision makers can do better decision, so that policy recommendations is another benefit using deep learning. Health education. Nowadays, many mobile app or internet service can do health education for patient. If the app understand the patient situations and data better, their education will be much more personalized and effective. Outreach. As you know, medical service is very expensive, so that many patients in the world to visit doctor's office. But if a machine learning agent can help the people to decide proper decision with no cost or very little cost, it will help to outreach poorer people. One of the key issues in public health is finding the source of disease and cause. Prevention is the most important issues. We expect machine learning also can help these issues too. Finally, machine learning also can decrease the healthcare inequalities. For pharmaceutical industry, machine learning also can do many things. Typically, this is the pipeline of developing new drugs. Start from ideas, basic research, including animal studies. For them, then there are typically three phases of clinical trials. After that, we need to get approval for this new drug from regulatory agency. And this is not the end. We need to know and monitor this drug is working well and what will be the side effect. We believe that machine learning can be helpful for every pipeline process here. This is the diagram from CB Insight. CB Insight has a very good report for AI. Every year, they are publishing quite good report on AI in healthcare industry too. I want to show you this diagram because we need to know really many areas exist in healthcare industry. This is the field that many companies and startups need to collaborate to make some progresses. It is totally different from consumer internet business. This is not covering every details AI healthcare, but as you can see, many medical imaging and diagnosis startups were created, and many of them are doing very well. One of them, Lunit here, is my investment portfolio. And there are several startups dealing with mental health and virtual assistant. Some of the companies are using wearables to promote health using AI technologies. In the hospital, already many companies are actively working for patient care and hospital management. or some of them are more focused on emergency room or surgery. Nutrition and lifestyle management monitoring is also very important for wellness, and nowadays, more research-based deep learning companies and patient data and risk analytics are growing. This is the diagram from Lunit's oncology brochure. I like this diagram very well. We are experiencing another paradigm shift on the medicine. Before 1990s, medicine was just like art. Every doctor has their own opinion, and since they have their license and authority, it is very difficult to challenge their decisions. Education was done just like master-apprentice relationships. It changed in 1990s. More and more insurance system governed the medicine. They requested to make some guidelines for payment and right decision. To deal with this request, evidence-based medicine is now the de facto standard. Every medical decision should be made with evidence, and such a guideline needs to be made based on very strict scientific scrutiny. It made medicine totally different from before. Actually, many inexperienced doctors was gone, and the average quality of the medicine was much better than before. But there are also trade-offs. Making evidence is very high cost and time-consuming jobs. Even though you've got some evidence, when you are practicing, it takes very long time and cost to change previous guideline. It's easily take 10 years to 20 years. Why this process is taking so long time and paying big cost? Because it depends on many doctors' agreements. And they are get together once a year, and always conservative positions are majority without clear evidence. This has very big problem. Let's say one doctor find out this is wrong treatment and that is better, and it takes 20 years to agree everybody, and it is now guideline for payment from insurance system. Is it okay? Well, through those 20 years, every patient got deprived of better treatment options. I think this is not ethically acceptable. We need to overcome this disadvantage for evidence-based medicine. Fortunately, I think machine learning and deep learning can alleviate this problem. We can now access to large-scale digital data in hospital, and using deep learning technologies, we can make many evidences with the support by deep neural networks. This kind of accomplishment need to be supported by medical data, so we can say it as data-driven medicine. I think we are now entering totally new medical paradigm, data-driven medicine. Under the graph here, this is the bar that representing the degree of deep learning software's accomplishment. We can now detect abnormalities 10 out of 10 doctors can also do. It is called easy task. If 50% of expert can miss and AI can detect, it can be called intermediate task. If 1 out of 10 doctors can detect but AI can do, then it is hard task. If no human experts can detect the abnormalities and AI can, it will be very challenging task. But already some of the projects are entering these tasks. Finally, AI can do more than detection. It will translate clinical implications and provide unprecedented insight. Then we'll be at the medicine with a totally new paradigm. Still a long way to go, but we can make the goal like this. Okay, this is the first lecture. I hope many researchers and entrepreneurs to innovate medicine with deep learning to like this lecture. I'll be back in next week with a subject for the types of medical data and different approaches for them. Thank you very much for listening to this lecture.